Nobody's new here this evening, so I'll be brief about this. We started in Habakkuk 2:4, and because of the studies that we've talked about before, that led us to a discussion of the Psalms of Ascent, which take us to the mountain of the Lord, which is the place of victory. And based on the word studies of Emunah, the word for faith, and the word Amal for pride, we saw that pride led to defeat, and that faith led to a victory over the Amalekites. So how do we get to that place of victory? Well, we have to defeat pride. This slide summarizes all the Psalms of Ascent, and tonight we're going to focus on Psalm 131. The short version is that this psalm shows someone with genuine contrition, genuine repentance. And there's a lot that's too hard for us, but nothing is too hard for God. So that's sort of the one sentence takeaway of tonight's study. Let's look at some key points for the psalms leading up to this and pay particular attention to our key words that I've highlighted in the different colors, because these are sort of the key points from each psalm that characterize either the condition of the psalmist or the key part that helped him to overcome. So when he started the journey, the psalmist was in distress, and it was personal distress. It was his own circumstances. He was dwelling in the tents of Kedar. He was a long way away from the temple of God. So he's out of fellowship. His personal circumstances are a disaster. He's very distressed, and he's worried about his own condition. And then in Psalm 121, either through someone's testimony or the revelation of the Spirit, but he realized that he could look to God for help. And he became glad when they said, "Let's go to the house of the Lord." And so it's a call back to fellowship. So a recognition that God could help him, and then he's glad, yeah, I want to get back into God's presence. He wants to close the distance between himself and God. And then in Psalm 122, we see God's grace entering in. And we see a change in his attitude. He hasn't gone anywhere yet. But now, because of God's grace, his concern is directed more towards God's kingdom than his own. And so grace makes a change in his heart. And these first handful of Psalms are all about changing a person's heart. Psalm 123, he prayed to the Lord to have mercy. And in Scripture, grace, mercy, and peace. That's the sequence. Sometimes it's just grace and peace. Mercy is literally the removal of misery. Grace is the divine influence of the heart. We don't deserve either one. Both are motivated by love, but they're two distinct things. Grace involves things that God puts into our life. Mercy usually involves the removal of misery. That's literally what the word means, is to remove misery. When we ask for mercy, that's an admission of guilt. We don't want justice because we know we're guilty. And again, that's an outcome of God's grace. We realize, yes, I'm guilty. Don't give me what I deserve. Please, Lord, show me your mercy. To prevail over pride, we must not boast in our own wisdom from departing from the path of destruction. And in Psalm 124, the psalmist recognized, except that God had acted on our behalf, we would have not known that we needed mercy. It's like Paul says in Galatians, the law is our schoolmaster. It teaches us that we've deviated from God's law. It exposes our peril, because we've sinned against God. But if God hadn't revealed that to us, we wouldn't have known. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And so that was the key point there. So he was distressed. Then he realized that God could help him. So he became glad. And then he began to think more about God's kingdom than himself. And then he realized that he needed the Lord's mercy because he'd done wrong things. And then he recognized that he wouldn't have had that awareness if God hadn't revealed it to him. Psalm 125, we then focus on trusting in the Lord. We're at his mercy. He can do anything we want. We realize that we are guilty, and we have to trust the Lord that he won't. And when we studied Psalm 125, we spent a couple sessions on eschatology to show how God has ordained things from the beginning to the very end, and that he's going to take care of us throughout eternity. So if we can trust him to take care of us forever, it seems a much smaller thing for him to take care of us today, tomorrow, and next week, regardless of how the election turns out. Finally, in Psalm 126, so Psalm 120 through 125, we're all looking at changes between the head and the heart. The pilgrim has not gone anywhere. But when you get to Psalm 126, the captives have been released, and now it's time to make physical movement. And the Jews were set free from their captivity in this psalm. And in that, it says that the Gentiles and the Jews both recognized that in spite of their carnal reluctance to die to self, God still delivered them in spite of themselves. But for his name's sake, he did it. He didn't do it because they were a better looking people, a smarter people. Usually when he describes them, he says they're stiff-necked, stubborn, rebellious. But for his name's sake, he set them free and allowed them to leave that land of captivity and exile. And when they go, you have to go with doubtless confidence. Again, faith. Because when we're going to return to their homeland after being exiled, they're going back to a place where the land had been ravaged, everything that they known had been destroyed, and it was going to be a time that was difficult, because even if they planted crops as soon as they get there, it would be an entire season before they would be able to reap the fruit of that harvest. So they had to have trust in the Lord to even make that step to go back, and that's why so few actually returned. Out of the millions that went into captivity, there were less than 100,000 that came back after the 70-year exile. Once you get back, you have to rebuild. Logically, Psalm 127 follows. We have to rebuild in obedience to God's instruction, and we must rely on him to defend or maintain our houses, cities, and families. So we studied rebuilding houses. And they had to be careful how they rebuilt, because they went into captivity, because things went off the tracks. They started worshiping other gods and getting all tangled up in the world. And so when they rebuild, it says, you know, unless the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. So when we rebuild, we got to do it the right way, and we have to do it in the Lord's structure, or it's a house of cards that's going to collapse. Therefore, we should fear the Lord, because he has the power to consign us to heaven or hell. This fear of the Lord, when we study that, we see and recognize in the passages that we studied, said that God's power transcends life and death. People of the world, the power of the world, when we go to the grave, the world can't touch us anymore. But dying doesn't get you out from under God's control. Actually, it puts you exclusively under his influence, because he's the only one left on the other side. He's the ultimate authority. We should fear him. And yes, it means respect. It means reverence. But if you're not covered by the blood of Jesus, God's going to be real scary when you stand before the white throne. You don't want to be there. We saw that in eschatology. There were three judgments. There's the Bema Seat of Christ. I had that one color-coded green because everybody's the Bema Seat of Christ. Even if they're saved by fire, they get to enter into their rest. Then there's one I color-coded yellow. That's the judgment of the sheep and goats. That's the judgment of the nations at the end of the tribulation period. Some enter into the millennial kingdom on earth. Others depart into everlasting darkness. So that judgment, there are winners and there are losers. So I color-coded that one yellow in our eschatology study. Then there's the one I color-coded red, the white throne judgment. If you're not up in the jury box or choir loft or whatever, if you're down in front of the judge's bench, you're headed towards the flames. No one comes out of that one. They'll get their wish to be judged by their works. And like Belshazzar found out, you've been weighed in the scales and found wanting. Psalm 128 highlighted the blessings for fearing the Lord. Wife is a fruitful vine. Your children around the table. Your children meet their enemies in the gate. Strong families, healthy families, children, grandchildren. Those are the blessings for fearing the Lord. Psalm 129 was a contrasting psalm. That psalm showed the fruitlessness of pride, like trying to harvest grain off a rooftop. You wouldn't get enough to even make a handful. Then Psalm 130, brokenness. Brokenness was the key to overcoming pride because we recognize that we've sinned against the God we fear. Yes, there are these blessings, yes, there are cursings, but we look at our lives and we say, I deserve the curse. I've sinned against the God I fear, that big scary God that created all of this and can wipe it all away with a sweep of his hand. I've done things to make him angry. Don't want to be there. And we went through and we saw in some detail that we cannot save ourselves. Our only hope is to wait on the Lord and to become intertwined with him. And both the Hebrew words for hope and waiting, we saw overlapping meanings with those. But both of them had the idea of becoming intertwined. So as we wait on the Lord, we are to be intertwined with him, to entangle ourselves with him, if you will. Praying, fasting, being in fellowship, drawing close to him, that's all part of this waiting process. And hope and waiting, again, they were synonymous terms. But it's a brokenness because we realize, really, we've got nothing. Like Pastor A has been saying of late, as he gets older, he finds himself sinning less but repenting more. Because we realize that even at our best, that all our righteousnesses are as filthy rags, as it says in Isaiah. See, you're starting to get there. You know, when I was younger, I was pretty good today or pretty good this week or whatever. And then as you get older and the Lord reveals more and more to you, you realize that, God, you're merciful to me today. I don't deserve another breath. And yet he's faithful and he's there. But that's part of the spirit that we uncovered in Psalm 130 is just this brokenness. I can't do anything right. It's true, and yet, Dorothy and I went to see the movie I'm Not Ashamed about the Columbine thing. Yeah. It's a very good movie, but the girl that the story focuses on, she was not a perfect vessel, and I found great encouragement that God was able to use a very flawed vessel, and this will come up a little bit more when we read the psalm. Let's go ahead and read this because I want to touch on that just a little bit more. Psalm 131, Lord, my heart is not haughty, nor my eyes lofty. Neither do I exercise myself in great matters or in things too high for me. Surely I have behaved and quieted myself as a child that is weaned of his mother. My soul is even as a weaned child. Let Israel hope in the Lord from henceforth and forever. That first phrase there, first verse, neither do I exercise myself in great matters or in things too high for me. That made me think of that movie. Because this girl was, she was going through a kind of a spiritual journey, and she had a lot of struggles, so gave in quite a bit to peer pressure, but she was beginning to, from our perspective, get her act together towards the very end. And just when things seemed to be coming together for her, she is one of the people that gets killed in this massacre in the Columbine High School. It's an account of this, and it's based on her diaries. But I found great encouragement in that God was able to use a flawed vessel in such a great way. And yet, this thing about concerning ourselves with things too high for us, what a tragedy. It seemed like she was just getting her life together. She's, 17 or 18 years old at the most. And getting her life together, she's starting to be strong for the Lord and reaching out to people and encouraging a lot of people around her. And she's one of 13 people that got blown away that day, specifically for following after Christ. That was one of the things that drew attention to the people that were doing the killings that day. And so we don't understand why a loved one gets sick, or a child is born with a deformity, or things just go south in a business relationship or something like that. But this, remember, we had to go back to Psalm 125, and there's this trust factor. We have to trust that the Lord is going to take care of us today, tomorrow, in eternity. Key thoughts here. We're going to look at words talking about things too high. That's actually a phrase that's used to translate a single Hebrew word. And we're going to see that Scripture is going, when we look at the first occurrences of these words, this idea of weaning and the things too high for me, Scripture is going to connect those, and we're going to see that they concern some elements of Isaac's life, both of those words together. So Scripture links those words. And then the word hope shows up again, which we spent a couple sessions discussing. So let's begin to unpack this a little bit. But it's very important to understand the context. That's why I spent a little bit more time. We've been coming through a progression, and we just left the psalm that was discussing brokenness and a recognition that we've sinned against God. So we're looking at the testimony of a changed life. Without the benefit of Psalm 130, one might think that the opening verse of Psalm 131 is a prideful statement. I've not been haughty. I've not lifted up. Well, of course we have, because that's just what people do. But, and this is one of the things that surprised me when I looked at the Psalms and said, I never really appreciated that there was a context in the Psalms and the way they flow together. I don't know if once we get outside the Psalms of Ascent, but certainly within this collection of 15 Psalms, there is a continuity, there is a flow. And so we have to discuss Psalm 131 in the context of what has been developing, and especially Psalm 130. So we're dealing with a man who has a broken spirit in a good way. He realizes his pride is largely broken. He's contrite. What we're seeing here is the testimony of a changed life. 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. Behold, all old things are passed away. All things are become new. So he's truly contrite. He's recognized that his natural tendency towards pride, sinfulness, and his inability to do that which is spiritually good. He's much like the Apostle Paul towards the end of Romans chapter 7. He says, "Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death?" The things that he wants to do, he doesn't do, and the things that he knows he shouldn't do, he does them. So even the Apostle Paul was aware of this struggle. So the opening verse contains the one whom God has literally or figuratively raised from the dead by his Spirit and his grace. Romans 8:11, the same Spirit that raised Jesus Christ from the dead dwell in you. He will quicken your mortal bodies. Ephesians chapter 2, the first 10 verses, speaks of being transformed from death unto life. And towards the end of it, it talks about being saved by grace, as quoted earlier. Similar theme in Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 through 14. In short, our pilgrim has prevailed over pride, but he realizes that he didn't do this on his own. We have limitations, but God doesn't. God knows everything, and we don't. Now go back to the original sin. Part of the motivation for Adam and Eve to eat the forbidden fruit was to become wise like God. And naturally, all humanity regrets their choice in the matter. But David understood that some things were too high or too wonderful for him to understand. So this is our first word study that we'll look at tonight, the Hebrew word pala. Something too high or too wonderful for him to understand. So one of the candidates for the first occurrence, Job, said that God did great and unsearchable things and marvelous things without number in Job 5:9. Okay, he believed that early on. And I think we can identify with Job. We're all believers here. We know God does great and wonderful things. We believe that he created the heavens and the earth, just like Job did. We know it. We believe it. And yet, Job went through these things where, oh, if I could only get my day in court with God, only if I could talk to him face to face, only if I could get him to hear me and answer my questions, I'm sure we could clear up this whole misunderstanding. And then God quizzed Job from the whirlwind, and Job began to appreciate more fully the limits of his understanding. And so for three chapters, from Job 38 through the end of Job 41, God explained some things to Job. God asked Job a bunch of questions. Job didn't have a lot of answers. And just before God turned things around for Job, Job realized that he had been opining on things that were too wonderful for him, and he repented. So the word pala shows up again in Job 42. He finally got to that place where the psalmist is in Psalm 131. I've been speaking about things that are too wonderful for me to understand, so far beyond what I can comprehend. And God never did answer his question. After God finished explaining some things to Job, he just said, "You know, God, you got it covered. No need to explain to me. What am I going to do anyway if he explains something to me? Write a book? Go on a talk show? There's nothing there." So that's the outcome of looking at Paula in the book of Job, the Bible's oldest book. So now let's look at the other candidate for the first occurrence of Paula in the law, Genesis, and that concerns the birth of Isaac. When the heavenly beings told Abraham that Sarah would bear him a son in the coming year, she laughed. God asked Abraham why Sarah laughed, and then asked him, "Is there anything too hard," that's the Hebrew word pala, too hard, "for the Lord? For Sarah and Abraham were quite old. So that was used in Genesis 18:14. So Isaac's birth was a wonderful thing. Hebrew word palah. This is one of many instances in Scripture when God chose to operate outside the realm of human understanding and experience. He can do that. God will never contradict himself, but he might seem to contradict some of our human experience. Laws of physics, what we call laws, but maybe our laws are a little bit flawed. You know, the mathematicians are always working on how to get the unified field theory and get all the properties of gravitation and magnetism and electronics and all these other things to come together in one master equation. And they haven't gotten there yet. So there's things about the laws of nature that we don't know. But that doesn't stop them from inventing stuff like evolution and some of these other theories where they try and write God out of the equation. And they're gonna run into problems because the creator of the universe, he knows what all the equations are. He knows how this all fits together. And though he might do something that defies some of our physical laws, he knows things we don't know about. He's got resources that we cannot even conceive. So he won't contradict himself, but he might do things that run counter to our experience, our wisdom, and our knowledge. Well, as promised, Isaac, whose name means laughter, Yitzhak in Hebrew, was born at the appointed time, probably in the spring, I'm guessing. That is just a guess. Remarkably, Isaac being weaned, the Hebrew word gamal, is the next event recorded in Scripture as touching his lifetime. And it contains the first two occurrences of this Hebrew word, gamal, Genesis 21:8. Well, in the psalm that we're now studying, the same meaning of gamal, to be weaned, also occurs twice in Psalm 131:2. So the first occurrence of palah in the law concerned the birth of Isaac, and the next key word that we're studying also concerns Isaac and his weaning. So we've gone from his birth to his weaning. Verse 1, the word linked up with his birth. Verse 2, linked up with the weaning of Isaac. So there's a progression there. So let's look at the word gamal. The empirical rule, which I describe in my book on the alphabet, links gamal with the name of the third Hebrew letter, which is gimel. Is the way I pronounce it, or gimal. The letter yod is a vowel letter, and according to the empirical rule, if you drop out the vowels and just look at the remaining consonants, you have the same thing. So if you take yod out of this, you get gimel, mem, and lamed in both words. So since that was the name of one of the Hebrew letters, I got a whole chapter on this. So it's something that I've previously published, and so there's a lot of information from which to draw. And when we were studying hope and waiting on the Lord with Psalm 130, we found ourselves in a discussion of the number 3 because of that word to hope or to gather first occurs in the third day of the creation account. Well, gimel is the third letter, so we have this idea of 3 creeping back in here. Now, gimel's picture, so the Hebrew letter gimel, its ancient character actually showed the uplifted head of a camel. I don't know if anybody's familiar with Greek, but the uppercase gamma kind of looks like a thing like that. And it's the uplifted head of a camel. Gimel, C and G are what are called cognate letters. So you go from one language to the other. Sometimes you go from one language to another, a C sound will turn into a G sound. So that's what I mean by cognate. They're similar. Well, you've got the M sound, the M sound, the L sound, C and G are cognate letters, and then the other ones are vowel sounds. So you can see Kimmel and Gimmel, Camel and Gimmel, are actually cognate words. So our English word for camel is actually a cognate to the Hebrew word gimel. So they have the same linguistic elements in them. Well, when we talked about that, this is going back almost a year now, because Gog, which I think you're familiar from Bible prophecy, Gog and Magog, and you have the Gog-Magog invasion of Israel and the end times prophecies, Gog is spelled with two-letter gimels. And so that was pride in the picture, pride doubles. So Gog, Agag, which were the Amalekite kings, and you know, again, go back to our original summary slide where the Amalekites were involved with pride. Agag was the name of the Amalekite kings. And so the ruler of the Amalekites would be the most proud, or the head. And when we did Psalm 129, we talked about the rooftop. Again, the top was Gog. That's the Hebrew word. The top of something. So pride is all about being on top. And so in this case, we're talking about weaning. So we're getting weaned off of pride. Since Psalm 131:1 showed our pilgrim's deliverance from pride, links to Gimel and its related words will understand how deliverance from pride occurs. So the published work I referred to there is my book on the alphabet. From that book, studies related to Gimel concerned God removing uncleanness, which is a way of, uncleanness would be a way of describing pride. So removing uncleanness from the kingdom of heaven through Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. And so that's summary of, you know, probably 40 or 50 pages of study, kind of at high level. Well, Scripture records events in Isaac's life that depict these very ideas. So let's talk about Isaac's weaning. At the feast held in honor of Isaac's weaning, Sarah saw Ishmael mocking his half-brother, who was probably about 13 at the time. He might have been actually older. There were 13 years age difference, and he was probably weaned. So he was a teenager. She demanded that Abraham send Hagar and Ishmael away. In Genesis 21, 9 and 10, Sarah emphatically stated that Ishmael, the son of the bondwoman, would not be an heir with her son Isaac. To Abraham's dismay, God told Abraham to heed Sarah's words, because Isaac was the son of promise and not Ishmael. Despite Abraham saying in Genesis 15, "Oh, let Ishmael live before thee," or "Let Ishmael live before thee." Well, Hagar was an Egyptian, according to Genesis 16:1, and Scripture frequently associates Egypt with worldliness, bondage, and spiritual adultery. And there's a string of references there. Ishmael was conceived when Sarah gave Hagar to Abraham as a wife, because the Lord's promise of a child seems slow in coming. And we all know how that worked out. They mistakenly concluded that God needed their help to fulfill his promise of an heir. And this is pride. What's the matter, God? Can't cut it? Well, let me step in and give you a hand. What could go wrong with that? Well, pride and faith cannot coexist. Our discussion of Psalm 130 and the number 3 revealed that to overcome pride, we had to recognize our own impotency in delivering ourselves from our predicaments. Sarah and Abraham, they recognized their impotency, but they tried to fix it. They tried to figure a way to help God out. Sarah realized that her human efforts only mocked what God had done in removing her reproach. So by the time it was time to wean Isaac, she began to better understand the folly of what she had done probably 15, 20 years but earlier. This understanding compelled her to drive away the fruit of pride, lest the inheritance of the true Son of Promise be marred. And that's a hard thing, especially for Abraham. I mean, there was this strife between Hagar and Sarah, but Abraham was the biological father of both, and yet he had to do a very hard thing, and he had to send his son away, his firstborn biological son. Although he was a teenager, that might have made it easier. I know things were different then. Personally, we must guard ourselves from creating our own Ishmaels through impatience or lack of faith. And that's the key thing, is we can't get impatient with God. If we know there's nothing we can do, don't do anything except wait on the Lord. Again, we go back to Psalm 130. This is where we're coming from. Waiting on the Lord, hoping in the Lord, trusting in the Lord, becoming intertwined with Him. Not saying, you're not cutting it, God. I need to step in and lend a hand. This isn't going to my pace. See the difference. This is why waiting preceded this one, preceded this psalm. Because if we don't know how to wait on the Lord, if we don't know how to hope in the Lord, we end up creating Ishmaels. God does not need our help. He wants our obedience. 1 Samuel 15, obedience better than sacrifice, to hearken better than the fat of rams. Mark 12:33, love God with all the heart, with all the understanding, with all the soul, with all the strength, to love his neighbor as himself, is more than the whole of burnt offerings and sacrifices. So as we discussed in the prior psalm, prayer and fasting while we wait on the Lord helps us to know his will. Following the weaning of Isaac, the next event that Scripture records in Isaac's life is his journey to Mount Moriah with his father. After dwelling many days in the land of the Philistines, Abraham offered Isaac on Mount Moriah. Now, the phrase there, many days, in Hebrew, that is an indefinite time expression. In Scripture, it's been used to describe a few days, a few months, or centuries in the references cited there. So, we can't get any inference about Isaac's age when he went to Mount Moriah. When they went up, Abraham carried the fire, Isaac carried the wood. But this tells little of his age because a bigger sacrifice would take more wood. So there's no information there. No matter how old he was, whether he was 5 or 35, it was a heavy burden. And it, by carrying the wood, it's an image of Christ carrying his cross. God provided a substitute and reaffirmed the covenant promises in Genesis 22, verses 11 to 17. In this blessing, God added that Abraham would possess the gate of his enemies. This is the last time that Scripture records the Lord speaking to Abraham about the covenant promise. The covenant had been fully consummated. The Lord said, "Because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." So he didn't even, in the Lord's eyes, he didn't even reckon Ishmael as one of Abraham's sons. In this instance, he says, thy only son. Because the seed had to come from Sarah, going all the way back to Genesis in the garden. It was the seed of the woman. So it's the seed of the woman, it's the mother that was important for carrying on the messianic image. So you have the father offering his son on a hill, Mount Moriah, as far as we know, is in the vicinity of Jerusalem, whether it's Calvary or where the temple was located. People dispute that, but that was the location of it. So you have Isaac in a figure of Christ carrying the wood, his cross, if you will, up to the top of the mountain. Abraham's told to slay his only son, but the angel held his hand, stopped him. Then you have substitutionary atonement. He provided the ram. And then in a prophecy, he said, he called the Lord Yahweh Yireh, or Jehovah Jireh, in the mount of the Lord, it shall be seen. So one day, he's going to provide the sacrifice. It will be seen on this mountain what just happened here. And that's a picture of Christ, his son. And just as an aside, it talks about Abraham coming down the mountain, but it doesn't mention Isaac. He's conspicuously absent in the description of who came down the mountain. It talks about Rebekah as being the sister of Laban, daughter of Bethuel. She gets mentioned in Genesis 22, but not Isaac. He doesn't show up until in the narrative again, until Genesis 24, when he's meeting his bride. And she lights off a camel, gimel, the same word. So if we track that word study a little farther, we would get all the way to the second coming of Christ. Jesus died, resurrected, and disappeared. So he's out of the picture. When's he seen next? Meeting his bride. So Rebecca is a type of the bride of Christ or the church. And I actually got that part of the story when I was working this week on my study in Lamentations. So the Lord just orchestrates all this wonderfully together. So we have a picture with Isaac going to Mount Moriah of the crucifixion of Jesus, and then you follow the narrative a little bit further, second coming of Christ, and an image of the church through Rebekah. Back to our narrative, this question about how old was Isaac. I cannot prove it conclusively, but I suspect that Isaac was about 5 when this happens, and you'll read commentaries that try to carry the analogy with Jesus and say that he was in his early 30s when this happened. I can't disprove that, but I'll make my case for 5-year-old Isaac. And you can read about people making their case for a 30-something Isaac. There's not enough information to say conclusively. At age 5, in that culture, boys left the care of their mothers and were trained by their fathers or placed in the special care of tutors or mentors. So at age 5, that was the transition, and that could be the definition of weaned. Leaving mom's care, turned over to dad. What do we do when they turn 5 years old? We throw them on a yellow box and send them off to be polluted by the state. Different culture. Scripture associates this transition with a child's weaning. The story of Hannah and Samuel in 1 Samuel. Same idea. So when he was weaned, he was turned over to Eli. The occasion of the journey to Moriah could have been Isaac's 5th birthday, or probably the way they reckon time. They didn't have calendars when they check off the days. It was probably his 5th spring. So the almond trees were blooming again for the 5th time, or 5 years since he was born. And so he knew that it was his season to be turned over to his dad. Fittingly, the first thing that Abraham taught his weaned son at the Lord's direction was to worship God. So there's a message for fathers. So that ship sailed for most of us, but I guess Tony's still in the running. But the first thing when he was turned over into his father's care is he taught Isaac how to worship the Lord. Here, crawl up on this altar. Let me show you about worship. Laying all on the altar, that wasn't just an English idiom for Isaac. There was a sense of reality there. Now, the purpose of this trip would have made sense to Sarah and spared her any significant anguish concerning the journey, other than natural maternal concerns about long-distance travel. I'm going to take the boy on a 3-day journey. What you going to do? Oh, I'm going to pile him on some wood and slit his throat. I don't think he would have made the trip if he'd, I'm going to take him and I'm going to show him how to worship God. That's all you need to know. The lad and I will return, which is what he told the travelers when he left them at the base of the mountain. Childlike faith. Jesus said that a person must be converted and to become as a child to enter the kingdom of God. And with Isaac as our example of a child, he had to trust his dad. Dad, I see the fire, I see the wood. Where's the sacrifice? And I like the way it reads in the King James. God will provide himself the sacrifice. And God did provide himself. He sent his son Jesus, who was also deity, who was also God. And he was our substitutionary atonement. God perfected praise and worship out of the mouths of babes and sucklings. Psalm 8. However, Scripture describes people unskilled in the word or in righteousness as babes still on milk. And this is why David wanted his soul to become as a weaned child. So not only are we talking about overcoming pride, but we're also developing the concept of spiritual maturity. We don't want to dwell on just the milk of the word. Yes, we understand the concept of sin. We understand the concept of salvation. But there are deeper things. And as we've seen in the last couple studies where we looked at hope and waiting on the Lord, that's not something children are good at. My wife can probably attest to that. They didn't like to wait.
Are we there yet?
Are we there? Can we open it now? Can we eat it now? Or in case of our older son, can I spend it now? Waiting is not a characteristic of someone that is immature. Waiting, so a weaned child, somebody that is weaned or develops some maturity, they have this concept of waiting on the Lord. And again, we see in the sequence. We talked about learning how to wait on the Lord and hope in the Lord in Psalm 130, 131. Yeah, I want to become as a weaned child. I want to know how to wait on the Lord. And I think that's a key to maturity. It's not just being able to win at Bible trivia or be able to quote verses and cite them on demand. Not that that's a bad thing. That just says you've got a lot of it up here. But to be able to put what you got up here into your heart and to wait on the Lord, to seek the Lord, to discern His will in some of these things that are very hard to understand. Remember verse 1. I'm not going to get involved in things that are too high, too wonderful for me. So when the hard things come, that's when you need to yield to the Lord, to sit, to wait, to listen to His voice. And waiting can be a very hard thing to do. David wanted to be able to handle God's word with skill and discernment, but without malice. Far too many like to use the sword of the Spirit as a weapon to beat people over the head, instead of as a surgical instrument to rightly divide the joints and the marrow and to do some of that fine, delicate work. And we want to use it as a club rather than as an instrument of surgery on other people. When we're fighting the enemy, yeah, you can go for the kill. But when you're dealing with other people, it's more of a scalpel than a sword or a club. In verse 3 of the psalm, David wanted all Israel to hope, the Hebrew word yakal, in the Lord. And again, we spent quite a bit of time on this in Psalm 130. David personally realized that God controlled many things that he could not.
David had a lot of trials, but despite his many trials, he had hope that God would preserve him through his tribulation. He also had a hope that even if God slew him, that God would eventually resurrect him. Job had this hope also. David wanted all Israel to see this for themselves. This is why he wanted to build a place that all Israel could come to worship the Lord and to learn his word. And quite fittingly, when we pick up Psalm 132, we're going to see a psalm that concerns the temple in Jerusalem. So we started our journey in the tents of Kedar and Dedan far away. We got all the way up to it. The next psalm, we're in Jerusalem, but we got to wait. Wait on the Lord, right? Thematic. So that's what I have for this evening. But it's this notion that as we mature, as we develop, as we become like one that is weaned, that implies that we've learned how to wait and to discern and to be patient, as well as getting skilled. Yes, we do need to build up our knowledge of the Word, our knowledge of Him, but it's more than assembling facts and information. It's gaining the Lord's wisdom as how to deploy those resources that He's put into our charge, whether it's knowledge of the Word or whether it's our talents, our gifts, or other resources.